Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Daiwa Anglo-Japanese Foundation. My name is Jason James. I'm just going to do the introductions and the housekeeping announcements to start with. So the housekeeping announcements are, please don't use the lift if the fire alarm goes off. It shouldn't go off, it hasn't gone off for ages, but if it does, you have to go down the stairs, down two floors, and out the front door, and we should congregate on the park side of the street. And the second thing is, please don't leave any valuables in our cloakrooms. And if you have left a laptop or anything like that down there, I suggest you pop down and pick it up, because nobody's monitoring those cloakrooms. So this evening, we're here to launch this book, Bridges. And quite a few of the bridges featured in the book are, I think, in the audience. So it's good to have so many of the stars of Anglo-Japanese relations with us. We have two speakers who have put together the book. The first will be Jeremy Hoare, sitting here. He is a travel photographer, and he has photographed more than 60 countries, but he says Japan is the best. I led him on a bit to say that, but that's what he said. He's had a number of exhibitions in both the UK and in Japan, and he's got another exhibition coming up actually in July called Kyoto Dreams, which will be held at Berg House in Hampstead. And he's also the author of a book which tells you how to take photographs, as
yes.
I understand it.
No, but I'll explain that to him.
Okay, right. And then our second speaker will be Suzanne Perrin, who is an independent researcher and historian specialising in Japan and Japanese history, art and culture quite broadly. She taught Japanese history and culture for 12 years at Richmond American International University and at Huron University here in London, and she continues to give lectures and courses on Japan. And she's published on a number of Japan-related subjects, including architecture, gardening, and lifestyle. But this is the first book, is it, that you've been involved
in? Project, yes.
So, over to you, Jeremy.
Okay, thank you. So, if you want to good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much all for coming on such a nice evening, I think. And thank you to Jason and everybody at Daiwa who's been so helpful in making this happen. But the main people to thank, of course, are the contributors for the book. And we have quite a number of them here tonight. So they are, without doubt, very, very welcome. So, that's that. Right, I'm going to start and talk to you about my life and how I got to this situation where I photographed these countries and also a lot in Japan, and also how I became to be involved with all this from a background which had nothing like it. This was 20 years ago in the room downstairs. I had my second exhibition. Bisha's smiling, she remembers it. So I've been here before, and I've talked here before in this room before, so it's quite interesting. I've got to find the right buttons. Here we go. What was that? Okay. It didn't go.
No.
It's gone now. It's gone now.
It's gone.
Okay. Okay. Right, I'm going to start a long way back. 1859, my great-grandfather, who was born just 6 years after Commander Perry sailed into Uraga Bay. That's a connection. The other connection was that he was a journalist and wrote various books. He had at one point he had a column in the Sydney Morning Herald. He interviewed Cecil Rhodes in South Africa, and he ended up writing a magazine called Field and Stream, editing rather, Field and Stream in America. So he was the first person in the family to go around the world, which I was a bit miffed at because I thought I was. But there we go. My grandfather We've had a slight glitch here, so I can't show you what I was intending to show, but never mind. He was a music hall comedy actor. He was in Fred Karno's army. It really was a Fred Karno's army. And they did a show, their most famous show was called Mumming Birds. This was the beginning of the 20th century. And he went to America, where he understudied Charlie Chaplin, who was in Fred Karno's army. And also Stan Laurel was in Fred Karno's army as well. Yes, I don't have the pictures. My father didn't go into performance. He went into theatre management. He started at Leicester Palace in World War II, and after World War II came to Wood Green Empire in London, a variety theatre, when theatre was dying and television was beginning to take over. I used to meet the stars of the day and go to see every show that went on there. He ended up at Theatre Royal Drury Lane, where he was for 25 years. But that was for the start of My Fair Lady. And he ended up being the archivist and historian for Stolmos Theatres, which became a really useful group run by Andrew Lloyd Webber. One of his great claims to fame was a young man who came to him one day when he was at the theatre and begged him for a job. He wanted to be in theatre business, anything. So my father got him to clean the brasswork outside the theatre. That was Cameron McIntosh. I started with a box camera, literally a box camera, not actually that one, but it was a start. And I went to the coronation with school and I took this with a box camera. It's a little bit blurry, which must be a camera shake, but it was a very dull day. So I was very young, so I've got my excuses. We were going with the school to Switzerland, so I needed a passport. So my father, to encourage me, bought me one of these, a Brownie 127, which was effectively a box camera, but in another guise. This is one of the pictures I took on that trip in Switzerland. That and a few others won me a school prize. So I left school age 15 with just that, no other qualifications whatsoever. And I went to work for ATV in the post room. And on the weekends, I used to go to the studio and act as a call boy. Now in these PC days, that may be a bit odd. It would be called a runner today. Getting people on the studio floor, getting them teas and coffees, just a general runaround. But I learnt the discipline of a studio. I'm just posing on a camera. But I wanted to be in the camera department. Years later, I became a cameraman, rose up through the ranks to senior cameraman. And this is at ATV Elstree. It was a show for disabled people we used to do every week. And I'm sitting on the Mole Richardson camera crane. The camera is an Emmy 2001, which was the cameraman's camera of that era and still today. Anybody who's used one would say it. And the person at the back of the arm is a woman, Helen Kingsbury, and she was the only female in the camera department. She was quite unique in her time. There are plenty of women camera operators now. I also ended up acting in things. This was a sitcom. And I did game shows. This was Family Fortunes, which originated with Bob Monkhouse, who was a nice guy. I met many, many stars over the years and worked with them. Just three I thought of. Joanna Lumley, who was great. She would sit in the bar afterwards with the camera crew rather than the actors, because she found our conversation more interesting. Bing Crosby was a very strange man, and we all found this absolutely amazing. He did not know the words to White Christmas. He needed idiot boards, as we call them, cue cards today, sorry. And Lulu was great fun. We did a whole series with her for the States. It was never shown here. And I got to know her very well. She was a lovely lady. But the biggest show I worked on that is known all around the world, of course, is the Muppet Show. We did that, it only struck me when I was putting this PowerPoint together, that I did that in 40 years ago. That was a long, hot summer of 76. We did the first series, first five series. And not only did we work on it, we actually performed it sometimes. And we operated these Muppets. That's me and the rest of the camera crew. So we're actually in the shows. And these shows have been seen by not millions, but billions of people. I went to Nottingham when Central moved there, and became a lighting director, and this is one of the shows I lit, Price is Right, for ITV Network and also Sky Channel. This was a children's program, and there was never any money for budgets for children's programming, so it was, can we do something with the lighting, which was fantastic, because I had a 3,000 square meter studio to do whatever I liked with. Wonderful. So I did this with this particular, it was a song, and that show went on and won BAFTA for Best Children's Program of the Year. I ended my television career with The Upper Hand, a sitcom with Honor Blackman, Joe McGann and Diana Weston. And when I was doing it, it was getting 10 to 12 million viewers every week, which today doesn't happen. But yeah, that was a different time. And it was a great show to go out of a television career. I wrote a book, not about photography, but about interviews with cameramen and actors, directors, writers, and people who worked on the production side of television and in front. Joanna Lumley wrote a chapter for me. I got Michael Grade, who was head of ITV at the time, to write forward. I even got Julie Andrews to write something for me because I'd known her for a very long time. I became a photographer and went into portraits. This is a Irish dance student, male model, opera singer, actor, James Herriot in All Creatures Great and Small, for those who might know it, and Pauline Bailey from St Albans. Not who you thought it was, but she's a great lookalike. Travel was another thing. I'd been interested in travel ever since my father got me to collect stamps as a kid. And I'm looking at these little rectangles thinking, where is that? And I'd look on a map and find it. And I thought, one day I'll go to those countries. And that's what triggered all these things together. So these are a few countries. This is Lake Matheson, New Zealand. San Blas Islands, Panama. Buenos Aires, Argentina. Mount Rushmore, USA. Seoul, Korea. Aitutaki, Cook Islands. Manila, Philippines. Tonga, that's the King of Tonga on his 80th birthday. Kuching in Sarawak. Isle of Skye. Australia, Western Australia, Esperance. Manaus, Brazil. Amman, Jordan. And of course, London and the UK. Which brings me neatly to how you've been wondering, how the hell did I get anything to do with Japan? So I'm coming to it now. Right, it started with my father, who every year used to get a Pan American Airlines calendar given to him. And one year was Itsukushima Gate in Japan, which fascinated me. I thought it was great. It took me nearly 40 years to get there, and the day I got there, the tide was out, as you can see. So it wasn't quite what I envisaged. But it was great to go, and it started my interest in Japan. The other person that started it was Yoko Ono, who I worked with on a program. We had a brief conversation, totally forgettable, but it triggered another interest in Japan. It was the time she met John Lennon, and I really liked the Beatles, so everything all sort of came together. I went to Japan eventually, Shinjuku, Tokyo, Kyoto, Gyomatsuri, and of course Hiroshima. The typical tourist route for a first-time visitor. But I was fascinated, like a lot of Western men are, with the geisha world. Some would pose for me. Her name was Satoka. She was very sweet. She posed in the street. I don't know what her name was, but she was doing a TV thing, and so she was stuck. So I was able to do that. But I decided I really liked a more paparazzi and impressionistic view of these women. They are entertainers. I felt no problem about chasing them around the streets to take pictures. So this impressionistic view is my view of how they are. It just makes them a bit more elusive than they might be. Also in other parts of Japan, this was in Iwajima Festival, some rather drunk guys having a great time, but made a great picture. And of course the gardens. This is a home in part of the Daitokuji Temple Complex in Kyoto, and one of my favourite places. I go there every time I go to Kyoto. And of course the downside. Tomioka, 10 kilometres from Fukushima Daiichi power plant, and the lovely Anne Kaneko, who used to work for Japan Society, took me there 3 years ago. We were there for an hour and she got really scared. We had a radiation meter and it kept changing, so I took pictures and we left, but it was interesting to see another aspect of Japan. I started an online photo gallery, Kyoto Photo Gallery, and the other person, and the real one of the main reasons why my interest in Japan has sustained all these years is a lady standing up the back there, Chizuko Kimura, my partner, who is a Urusenki tea master and has given a tea ceremony in a room downstairs 20 years ago. This is one we did in Derby at a cosplay convention, and the rather fetching platinum blonde is actually a bloke. She's also a kimono maker, I think one of the few in the country. So I've seen many aspects of Japan, and it's been fascinating, and I continue to go back and I always find new things. Everybody is so welcoming. It's just such an easy country to photograph in many ways. So we come to the link between four generations, and the common link is that we've all done something in the public eye for the public interest. My great-grandfather, grandfather, father, and myself have all done things which have been in the public eye. And I don't think there's a degree between us educationally. My father was certainly not well schooled. I mean, he went around in circuses and all sorts of places when his parents dumped him at various places. My grandfather would have had a similar existence. And my great-grandfather, I don't know, but I suspect, as he was the son of a haver from West Ironmonger, didn't have actually a great educational level. Which brings me back to 1894, my great-grandfather's book, and my book in 2008. And recently I found that my great-grandfather's book has been reprinted as recently as 10 years ago, which makes me ponder, will British be reprinted in 2120? Right, I think I pressed the wrong one. I think that's all I'm going to say. It's been a fantastic ride through my life and with Japan. Japan has been so interesting and such a wonderful country. And I've met so many people. The contributors to the book are in fact also terrific. And they were so good to give their time and energy to letting us do it. I think that's all I'm going to say, so thank you very much. Now I'll hand over to Suzanne Perrin, who is going to tell you about the contributors, which I didn't, but she will.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming here on such a lovely beginning of summer's evening, and thank you to Jason and Daiwa for hosting us for this, our first book launch event, which is very exciting for us. So we are very appreciative of everybody being here, and particularly for quite a number of our contributors to the book as well, who have also made the journey here. Thank you so much for coming. Well, we've had a good introduction from Jeremy. I'm not really going to talk about myself. I've got other people that I would rather talk about. So, it's taken us 5 years to get to this point. We started this project in 2011, and it has been a really illuminating collaboration with Jeremy and with the contributors and the other people we've been involved with along the way, and for the contributors who have all given their time most generously and with lots of patience for this project. The book is by no means perfect. In spite of the many, many hours spent editing and proofreading, there are still a few flaws in it, which we found, the main one being the erroneous title of Sir to Professor Bonus. Unfortunately, he was not given a knighthood, but did receive the CBE for his long service to Anglo-Japanese relations. So we apologise sincerely for that and have issued an errata slip for the book, and we'll get subsequent printings amended as we go along with that. In the introduction, we state that there were three seemingly unrelated events which made the beginning of this book project. The first one was undoubtedly the Tohoku tsunami and earthquake in March 2011, which was a shock to everybody in Japan and of course here, and caused us a kind of reassessment of many things to do with our relationship with Japan. Second one was the book launch of Professor Nishi's The Japanese at War and Peace, which was in May the same year, 2011, in this very room. And we came to that book launch of Professor Nishi's book, and we saw that it was packed with people who knew so much about Japan. There was a huge history of Japan just sitting in the room here. And that made us think about the resources to be found and to put into motion. And the third event was some time before that, an exhibition by Phillida Purvis here at Daiwa, again in 1997, called Bridges. It was curated by Phillida. It was a wonderful photographic exhibition which went then to Japan. And we asked her, and we took the name Bridges for our book, because it is very much about creating bridges between our two cultures. So these were the three kinds of events which started us off on our experience. So it was the idea of the book came about because of these events, but also to consolidate the knowledge at the time and the reassessment between our two countries. The aim of the book was and is to celebrate the work of a diverse range of people who have made a significant contribution to the understanding of Japan in the UK. And many of these people will be well known to you in this room. So I will talk a little bit about them all, but it might be very familiar territory because they are very well known people. So to explore this relationship, a key question was posed as the basis for the interviews. For the British, why Japan? And for the Japanese, why the UK? What was the attraction or rationale for the person's involvement with the other culture? Well, there were some surprising answers, as not all the contributors had chosen the opposite culture that was to become their career. In the words of Professor Ian Nish, they chose me, I didn't choose them. So this was a very interesting statement. So who knows where Professor Nish's career path would have taken him if it wasn't for the army officer saying, you, and you will learn Japanese in the very early days. As a generation of people working with Japan in the early post-war period, there are some significant similarities in their accounts. Both Sir Hugh Kotatsi and Professor Nish witnessed the immediate aftermath of the bombing of Hiroshima without sentiment or any of the trappings of modern disaster management. This led to a realistic approach when dealing with Japan to not sentimentalize, glorify, or gloss over the real issues at stake. From translating at Changi prison camp and breaking Japanese codes at Bletchley Park, people like Sir Hugh Kotatsi, Professor Nish, and Professor Geoffrey Bonus were instrumental in bringing the language of Japan into the mainstream of British education. Japanese studies as an academic area became more widespread in Britain during the 1970s and 80s as Japanese investment came to Britain and new funding bodies were set up, including Daiwa Japan Foundation here, for the greater dispersion of Japanese research and teaching. So these three people in particular, Sir Hugh, Professor Nish and Professor Bowenus, led the way for the advent of Japanese scholarship in this country. And they discuss the merits and the reasons why it was important to set up courses for Japanese studies at this time and to make use of the investment, because they wanted to see the relationship between Japan and the UK growing. So this is was a very interesting area for them to talk about at length in the book. Also, they provided us with a wealth of historical and academic writings on the subject of Anglo-Japanese relations. So Hugh Kotatsi studied Japanese language at SOAS in London and joined the RAF, going to Singapore, then to Japan as an interrogator at the war crimes trials in 1945-46. Working in the Foreign Office, he had three postings to Japan between 1951 and 1970, totaling over 12 years, before being appointed as the ambassador to Japan in 1980-84. With such an in-depth knowledge of Japan acquired over the years, Sir Hugh produced and edited many, many books on Japan and Japanese relations, including editing Britain and Japan, the Biographical Portraits, now in its 10th volume, I believe, and translating the memoirs of Crown Prince Naruhito when he was a student at Oxford, entitled Thames Totomo Ni, or The Thames and I, in 2006. Professor Nish was also assigned to translate Japanese at Changi Prison and in the interrogation center at Kure, Japan, at the end of the war. He came back to complete his degree in Japanese history at SOAS, then went to teach Japanese history at the University of Sydney from 1957 to 62. He then returned to London and went to the London School of Economics, LSE, to specialize in Japanese history and international relations in the Japanese department from 1962 to 1991, when he retired as Professor Emeritus. He was one of the editors of the major history project, the History of Anglo-Japanese Relations from 1600 to 2000, written in five volumes in 1995. Overall, Professor Nish has written, edited, and produced more than 200 works about Japan in over 300 publications, in four languages, in over 7,000 library holdings. A remarkable achievement for one who did not choose Japan in the first place. Another link with two contributors centers on the 1964 Tokyo Olympic Games. Both Professor Jeffrey Bonus and Professor Toshio Watanabe attended the Tokyo Olympics as young correspondents, and both met with the author Yukio Mishima at the time. They had some interesting observations about Mishima, but you'll have to read the book to find out what they are. We have been queried about the inclusion of Professor Bonus, who died a month before the Tohoku tsunami in February 2011. Had he lived, we would certainly have included him in the book for his pioneering work, combining Japanese language, culture, business culture with the academic world. Jeffrey was a classics scholar in both Chinese and Japanese, and first went to Japan in 1952 to study under Professor Kaizuka Shigeki, the foremost scholar on China. His first job was to translate Confucius into English. Jeffrey went on to set up the new Center for Japanese Studies program at Sheffield University in 1965 and worked with business groups to introduce Japanese management practices into the British workplace. His many publications include Doing Business with the Japanese in 2003 and The Penguin Book of Japanese Verse, third edition in 2009. His widow, Risha Cook Bowness, has provided some wonderful insights into his work and character in her interview for the book. Diplomacy and humanitarian work also feature in the book. Two veterans of these areas are Phillida Purvis and Keiko Holmes. As a young diplomat in Japan, Phillida Purvis had a long association with the embassy in Tokyo and the Office of Trade Ombudsman, dealing with UK imports, trade tariffs, and non-tariff barriers, arguing the case for such diverse import products as forklift trucks, weighing machines, bull semen, embryos, and semi-pornographic calendars. It's a testament to her diplomatic skills that she won over the all-male Japanese ministers every time. Phillida went on to become a prominent figure in Anglo-Japanese-related organizations, including the Japan 2000 Group, Deputy Director here at Daiwa from 1993 to 98, co-founder of the Burma Campaign Society, setting up Links Japan in 1998 to promote voluntary sectors, and many more. She's well known in this area. Coming from a tiny village in rural Japan, Keiko Holmes rose to prominence by pioneering the exchange visits of British POWs, POW veterans to Japan to meet their counterparts and jailers. It was a long and difficult road, and initially Keiko encountered a great deal of hostility from both English and Japanese people. But her Christian faith gave her strength, and eventually the POWs put their trust in her and went to Japan and there found the reconciliation that had been absent in their lives. Keiko was recognised for her unstinting work with Agape World, which she founded, gaining many awards, including the title of Companion of the Cross of Nails, given to her by Coventry Cathedral in the year 2000. Two aspects of grassroots level are given by Setsuo Kato and Joji Hirota. Setsuo Kato's journalistic approach and concern for the Japanese community living in the UK resulted in the long-running publication Nichie Times, which he put together and did himself, giving the Japanese residents a local newspaper for their own from 1991 to 2002. Setsuo also produced 13 books on British lifestyle, including two books on Scottish whiskey, which he assiduously researched up in Scotland, very amusingly, for the Japanese in the UK. He is also involved in many restoration projects, including the Japanese Garden at Hammersmith Park, London, and the Bernardage Pottery Restoration Project in St Ives, Cornwall, which he kick-started with donations from Japan. Setsuo is on the board of a wide range of organisations, including theatre projects, business groups, and somehow he still finds time to teach photography to students. Joji Hirota's musical repertoire has taken him all over the world, making him a truly global figure. His collaborations are many and various, and Joji worked for the Royal Shakespeare Company, pushing the boundaries of East and West in their memorable productions of Macbeth, Julius Caesar, Antony and Cleopatra, and many others. But more recently, his musical concern has been focused on the survivors of the Tohoku earthquake and tsunami, resulting in his Beyond a Requiem concerts, with all the proceeds going to the Tohoku Disaster Fund. The music features the heartfelt folk songs of the region, which he sings himself. In dealing with musical culture, identity and expression, we have the concert pianist Junko Kobayashi, who at the age of 5 years decided that she wanted to play piano, starting with a piano teacher in Kyoto. After moving on to the Osaka College of Music, she graduated from the University of Ruhr, Essen, in Germany. In 1980, Junko came to London to study piano with Maria Curcio and Louis Kentner, whose brother-in-law was Yehudi Menuhin. With such exceptional music teachers, Junko mastered the interpretation of classical Western composers such as Chopin, Liszt, Debussy, and Beethoven. Although Junko had absolutely no idea about Japanese music, her words, she was attracted to the music of Japanese composer Toru Takemitsu and co-founded the Toru Takemitsu Society in 1997 and was its chairman for 15 years, promoting and playing the work of Takemitsu, which was relatively unknown here at the time. In Robert Ketchell's case, he became an accidental apprentice to a famous Japanese gardener in Kyoto soon after arriving there on his way to India. He never got to India. Instead, he stayed for 3 years in Kyoto, struggling with the language, with his sensei, and with the work he was supposed to be doing. But this inauspicious start led to a deep and subtle knowledge about the relationship between Japan and nature, and the nature of gardens in a Japanese context. He went on to co-found the Japan Garden Society, creating many Japanese gardens in the UK and abroad, with particular reference to healing gardens for hospices and nursing homes. The crossing points of culture and identity have fascinated us for centuries. As Professor Toshio Watanabe observes, what is East and what is West? A lot of what we think of as West actually consists of a lot of East. It gets blurred. Professor Watanabe's mixed background, born in Switzerland to a Japanese father and a German mother, has placed him in a unique position to see both sides of the racial and cultural divide. His research is into the transnational nature of culture, the border territory between cultures, resulted in the setting up of the Research Center for Transnational Art, Identity and Nation, TRAIN, at the University of the Arts, London in 2000. TRAIN seeks to avoid any sense of a racial or cultural hierarchy, thus transcending the concept of us and them. His many publications include Japan and Britain, An Aesthetic Dialogue, 1850 to 1930 in 1992, Ruskin in Japan, Nature for Art, Art for Life, 1997, and the AHRB research project, Modernity and National Identity in Art, India, Japan and Mexico, 1860 to 1940 in 2001. Which brings us to the conclusion that we must all work in the borderless region between cultures to effectively build the bridges for cultural understanding, and which hopefully will continue with the generations to come. He used a term in his interview calling it porous borders of culture, and I rather like that kind of image of the sort of borders breaking down between cultures so that we can operate in this kind of area of borderless regions. So from this very brief introduction to our contributors, I think you can appreciate there is a very wide range of topics on discussion within the book, and they have provided us with a huge insight into many different areas of Japanese culture, but also UK culture, and how we can promote the two together in this globalised world. So once again, I do thank our wonderful contributors for the time that they've made to give us these interviews and for their help in editing and to putting it all together in this book, which I hope you will enjoy reading. Thank you very much.